To everyone who are joining us today. My name is Lily Shen, a year two student from Faculty Education and Psychology. I'm your moderator for today. Welcome to all school students, teachers, parents from all around Malaysia. Not forgetting all UMS students and all UMS staff present in this session today. Thank you, and we meet again for today's sessions of STEM Speaker Series. For those who joined us for the first time, this STEM Speaker Series is a core joint effort with the Institut Penyelidikan Marine Borneo UMS, aimed to deliver unique and interesting STEM topics, design, and subject matter expert to students, teachers, and community alike to venture in the field of STEM. Any questions from audience today, please feel free to drop your questions at the chat box at the right side of this YouTube live. Please be informed that for today's session, e-certificate will be given to school students and UMS students, but must fill in the form through a QR code, which will be shared at the end of the YouTube session. Before we start this program, I will introduce Dr. Rafida Othman. She is Secretary to Head Program of Aquaculture in UMS and currently teaching immunology of aquaculture animal. Her expertise is sorry that I accidentally closed the camera. So I will start again for introducing Dr. Rafida Othman. She is Secretary to Head Program of Aquaculture in UMS and currently teaching immunology of aquaculture animal. Her expertise is veterinary immunology, fish health, and diseases. She has received her PhD in 2013 at University Putra, Malaysia. She is a doctor of veterinary medicine in 1998 at University Britannia, Malaysia. She ever invited to evaluate the potential of aquaculture project at Balung Eco Resort Tawau. So, without further ado, please welcome Dr. Rafida Othman. Please be invited, Doctor.
Hello, yes. Thank you, Ms. Lee, for your kind and brief introduction. So, I would like to share my presentation for today. Wait, I have to look for a file. Wait, I will look for file. Sorry, will take some time. While waiting for the file to loading file to share. Assalamualaikum and a very good morning to everyone, teachers, students, and all our participants in this program. First and foremost, I would like to say you sign for organizing this event. And is it already? For organizing this event. And Okay, can you see for organizing this event and inviting me to give a talk on this topic, which is actually a question, which is do fish get sick? Did I share already?
Yes, doctor.
I just don't know why it doesn't move. Okay. Sorry, because I'm not familiar with this. Okay, so all right. So I will ask question, do fish get sick? So what do you think? Yes, actually fish do get sick. Like all other animals, all aquatic animals, including fish, as similar like other land animals, they're also getting sick. So you have to take care. Anyone of you student having fish in aquarium, or kalau ada family yang ada menternak ikan, aquaculture, so you have to take care of fish so that you have to feed them to make sure they are in a good condition. You know about animal welfare, which is animal welfare is they are very what important for us to make sure that every animals deserve to have a good life. So make sure they are healthy. So what is a sick actually? Atau sakit apa? It is actually afflicted with ill health or disease or ailing. So whenever kalau kita as a human, you can feel if you're not well, so you feel like not feeling good, like that. So in this case, fish, how do you know they are sick? Of course, they are not going to like burying, lie down, or taking a nap, or there is no coughing or sneezing. Like some mammals, animals, they can even like sneeze or just, but fish, they are not going to make any sound. You will be surprised if you have aquarium and then suddenly your fish in the aquarium said, "Hi, good morning, saya hari ini sakit." So you will be surprised, right? All right. So how do you know if a fish is sick? There were many physical signs and behavioral signs that you can observe. For example, for physically, you can see colors, the location, where is the physically affected, and how many percent of body affected that show changes in physically. And while behavior, you can see the position, how they swim, and their appetite. So you know that there are changes. However, in order for you to know those physical signs, you have to observe your fish. For example, you should, before it getting severe, normally you can see the skin discoloration. But in this picture, it is quite severe already. You can see a skin discoloration, pale, there are redness in color. You can also sometimes, if you have a fish in aquarium, white spot at their feet, their body, and even in worst cases, you can see open wound, ada luka-luka, and then the fin and tails, it's rot already, rotting. So it's not nice already. It's look bad like that. And then even if you try to get a close look into the gills, you can see the changes in color, appearance, and thickness, and sometimes you might even see there are parasites attached to the gills. This is example of a betta fish with frying fin, which is look not as beautiful as it is. So these are the showing changes physically. However, in behavior sign, you can see fish is gasping for air when fish going on the top of the surface, which is getting air. So normally this is happen when crowding and then there are lacking of enough oxygen, or the temperature may be getting higher, so less oxygen available. So these are the behavior that you have to observe in fish. Of course, if fish, if they can choose, they will move, but they have a very limited to move around in a very limited space. If they can, they will move and find a better place for them. So you better, maybe for you, changing water is not a big deal. So, but for a fish, they will thank you. So you make sure water is in a good condition, a good quality, so that they will have enough oxygen for them, clean and good for their living. So you can also observe swimming behavior. Normally, fish will have similar behavior or pattern of swimming. Of course, there are differences in species between fish. There are preferences where and how because of their differences. But of specific species, you can see they are normally having a pattern which is normal from day to day. For example, in this case, this fish is floating upside down, which is not normal. Normally, fish will swim at a very good condition. While in this goldfish, swim bladder disorder, it will make it a fish floating upside down on the surface of the water in the tank or aquarium. This is a example of grouper, which is we normally have this problem in hatchery. They're having a bloated belly, and then we have to like puncture with a small needle to help to get rid this air in the stomach. So this is a study where when a fish, they trial having problem with a swim bladder infection or constipation, this fish can make it hard for or impossible to swim with balance. So those disease or sick fish, they will show this inability to swim normally. So this is for example in tilapia, a circular pattern swimming that normally you can observe if you try to visit any farm, tilapia farm. This is a farm that I visited in Balu, and we come here with a feed, and then the tilapia is going to the top of the water for feeding because they know feeding time, and they will normally move in circular this pattern. Maybe you have experienced why is your fish swimming up and down. There, this erratically pattern of swimming, sometimes it indicate of stress in fish, whether it is stress due to water quality or stress due to there are parasite in on the surface or on the body surfaces, which is this fish normally trying to get rid of any organism because you know kalau ada parasite, they can try to get rid by moving erratically. But so, however, sometimes there are cases if you introduce fish into new environment. For example, you just get new fish and you introduce to a new aquarium. This is, they call it a glass surfing, which is, this is nothing to do with disease condition, but it is like curiosity to a new environment, which is, it won't last maybe just during adaptation only. So you have to know which one is a temporary because of the new environment, or it is because of okay. So behavior is actually a fast and easy to observe, which is, it is a better tools for assessment of fish health, and it will give you early diagnosis or disease, especially if you culture fish, because in culture fish you are taking care of a big number of fish. So if there is disease, you have to know as early as possible. So what causes,
sorry, doctor.
Yes,
the slide doesn't show at the YouTube live session. Can you reshare the slide?
Oh, all right. I have to reshare. Sorry. Now I got problem. Which button? Is it not showing anything?
The live YouTube live session only shows your camera.
Because, sorry, I'm not familiar with this WebEx. Where should I go? Sorry, saya pun mencari mana button unshare. Ada? Sorry.
Belum ada lagi, dokter.
Don't know how to tackle this problem. I can't find any I can't find any share button here. Should I left first? Because here, sharing. Yes. Tiada, there are Lee.
Masih tiada lagi.
Because kalau saya lihat di sini sharing it's sharing. Should I leave first?
Ada sudah, dokter.
Okay, so yeah, but so behavior is a very fast and easy to observe. Those provide a very useful tool for assessment of fish health, which is it will give early diagnosis for disease, especially in culture fish, because culturing in a big number of fish, you have to evaluate the culture. So what causes fish sick? So how to diagnose? Diagnose this fish if there are sick and what causes them. So if you heard about aquatic veterinarian, this is normally who look after animal health. So normally aquatic veterinarian, they will give routine vaccination, observing behavior, conducting a treatment or follow-up, and then do recommendation. But beside a veterinarian, there are also researchers, which is a non-veterinarian, but they have doing a lot of work related to fish. So they are all about fish. I remember with one of our prominent professor, Prof. Sino. He is a very famous with this aquaculture with fish. He always remind students, watch fish, talk to fish, think of fish. So for example, here is what I did in my recent research with OSU at USM. We are doing research about fish, getting sample and wanted to know about disease and so on about fish. So what is disease actually? It is very rare that disease only like host interaction with pathogen. Normally there are another factor which is between host pathogen, which is the organism and the environment. When these three main component interact, when there is not balance between host pathogen, then there will be disease, which is in under umbrella stress. Stress will lead to a very susceptible to disease with the available pathogen or in the environment and a very bad environment. If all these three criteria, which is a very minimum, of course pathogen, memang very hard for you to avoid langsung tiada pathogen. Even on the surface and our hands semua ada sentiasa pathogen. But with minimum number and with healthy fish, happy fish and healthy fish and a good environment, all these factor in balance, so you will be no, there will be no disease. It is a healthy fish. So what type of diseases that we have in fish? There are categorized, that can be categorized as infectious, which is involve microorganism. And then yang tidak berjangkit, non-infectious, yang melibatkan selain daripada organisme. So infectious diseases in fish are, there are viral infection. Kamu tahu macam COVID kan viral. There are bacterial infection. Many viral bacteria. And there are parasite infestation or infection, which is parasite. For example, this is a case of vibriosis, a bacteria which is a very common bacteria causing disease. This is a red snapper. You can see dia punya physically affected, ada redness, ada open wound, color changes, and the eyes also like bulging out. So this is vibriosis causing in a red snapper. Okay, tilapia leg viral is a viral infection. Dia ada physically sign, dia akan kehilangan scale, ada redness, hemorrhage, berwarna berubah, dia punya sirip pun berubah, atau jadi physically dia berubah. Ini pula, there are various parasite yang menjangkiti, affecting fish. Virus, parasite yang dalam gambar ni nampak kecil. That's why kalau macam ikan dalam bab ni, ikan aquarium, dia nampak redness. If you check under the microscope, you may find these are very microorganism parasite. There are also parasite yang besar, but this one is small type under this scale. But you can see there are changes dari segi physically. However, a good diet and clean water condition are one of the best way to prevent diseases in your fish. Sebab tu have to have a good environment. While fungal infection pula, dia a very opportunist organism. Normally fungal infection adalah secondary selepas bacteria, viral ataupun non-infectious. For example, wound atau cedera due to handling processes. Handling of fish, if you are causing mengganggu dia punya lapisan, then fungal will be opportunist. Dia akan secondary. So for example, dalam ikan gambar ni ada putih-putih like a kapas. Jadi this is fungal. This under microscopic how fungal look like daripada sampel ikan. So parasite ada yang kecil, ada yang besar. There are many news yang melibatkan bacterial infection yang ada di share juga betapa pentingnya penyakit pada ikan. Okay, quality Air adalah sangat penting dalam aquaculture. Very important, sangat-sangat penting. Di mana terdapat parameter, there are parameter like salinity, oxygen, carbon dioxide, pH, alkalinity, hardness, and then organic matter, nitrogen content. In aquatic, it is very important to maintain quality air. Sebabnya ianya melibatkan non-infectious diseases. Non-infectious diseases ini, for example, environmental risk factor and water quality. For example, kalau ada hujan yang lebat tiba-tiba, I mean terlalu lama dalam masa jangka yang masa yang lama, kebanyakannya akan merubah kualiti air dari segi temperature akan berubah, dari segi pH akan berubah, salinity akan berubah. Or environmental factor juga akan menyebabkan tercemarnya water quality, perubahan oksigen berlaku dan menyebabkan bila non-infectious ini kematian adalah serentak dan jumlah yang banyak berbeza dengan penyakit berjangkit. Penyakit berjangkit kematiannya sedikit-sedikit untuk jangka masa. Tapi kalau melibatkan kualiti air, dia akan berlaku dengan banyak dan serentak. Selain daripada environmental, dia mungkin juga berlaku chemical or other pollutants. For example, waste. Dalam berita ini, ratusan ikan Sungai Damansara mati keracunan. We used to dengar berita which is toxic material being dumped in a river atau di air. Even dalam gambar ini terlalu banyak sampah plastik atau kotoran yang dibuang di sungai. Jadi, when a fish is sick, the first thing you have to check is water quality. Because water quality can cause a fish to get sick more easily because they are living in the water which is contaminated. You just imagine how they can breathe with a contaminated water. So nutrition is another factor that can cause non-infectious diseases in fish. You have to know that like us juga, manusia and animals, land animal yang lain, ikan juga memerlukan nutrition yang berbeza-beza mengikut stages of age, peringkat pembesaran dia, dan juga mengikut species. There are fish yang herbivore, there are fish yang carnivore, and there are fish yang memang omnivore, buat kedua-duanya sekali. So, if you taken care of a fish, sama ada aquarium atau dalam kolam aquaculture atau dalam tangki, you have to make sure that you provide enough nutrition to support their growth and to support their punya energy and to support immunity. Otherwise, if you don't support all this requirement, the fish may get sick. So this is a research study. For example, when a group getting a treatment of different treatment of ascorbic acid, where you compare it will affect of certain lack of certain vitamin, or even other cases of minerals or nutrition, it will affect the growth and the spine, tulang belakang ikan. Jadi you can see ada bengkok dan ada yang kyphosis dipanggil. Jadi betapa pentingnya pemakanan yang betul untuk ikan kekal sehat. Okay, if you already know that your fish is sick, what to do if you know your fish is sick? So you have to observe in order for you to know that your fish is sick, the fish is sick. You have to investigate. You have to take sample, or you have to maybe taking a sample to the lab for testing. If you found out, then you have to treat them or taking measure for prevention so that it won't recur prevent another loss. Because maybe if aquarium, you might invest in a big, because there are effect, expensive fish kan yang mahal. But kalau dari segi aquaculture pula, iaitu penternakan perladangan ikan secara besar-besaran, jika ikan sakit, maksudnya kita akan kehilangan, iaitu dari segi kematian. Dan ini akan juga menyebabkan loss dari segi kerugian pelaburan. Jadi mesti ambil langkah berjaga-jaga dan sentiasa observe ikan, sentiasa supaya kekal sehat. Okay, I would like to share with you a real case. Recently, if you alert or if you aware, there are in the news, even Al Jazeera, saying that in Sipadan, ada diver yang observe mystery skin disease among shark. So, this have been questioned why, because they observe dekat area kepala shark, there are white lesion, ada seperti keputihan. So, my team, which is involve few expert, Dr. Mabel expert in shark, Mr. Ali and Mr. Davis, we went to Sipadan to investigate this disease shark. What might cause that shark? However, we have a few trips. We still not managed to get the sample because not easy to take a sample from wild, especially at the open sea. I mean, open in sea, you're not easy to catch them. And then there is another cases in 2015. If you baca, bila kamu pernah baca plastik punca ikan lumba-lumba mati. So you just imagine this is a non, just now we suspect infectious because they are whitish, but maybe secondary. This is ikan lumba-lumba mati plus berkaitan dengan punca dia plastik. This case, fisherman, they reported to us there is a stranded dolphin in the Lucas Bay early morning 5:30, and then we rescue and bring took the in our tank, taking care in our tank, big tank, this dolphin for 7 days with the help of wildlife department, give her feeding support. However, after 7 days, this dolphin did not survive. So I myself, this is me, conducting this postmortem just to investigate why this dolphin sick. So it is very surprising. Here is the stomach. When I cut open, the stomach is bloated and extended, distended. And when I touch it, it's very hard. And when I cut open, the stomach is full with plastic. Only small clumps amount about 100 grams, 150 grams of seagrass. The rest are seaweed. The rest is all plastic, various sizes of plastic. Up to 4.25 kilogram. Even there are tali caution apa ni yang selalu tape dipasang bila ada berlaku untuk apa ni supaya orang berjaga-jaga. 6.3 meters we found in that stomach. So no wonder that when I when we give feeding, support feeding, there is no way any food, any feed will able to pass through the stomach and go into the intestine. So the intestine, small intestine, very empty. So you just imagine how long this dolphin had been in this condition and hungry because the stomach is obstructed with this foreign material. So why? The important of healthy fish, because you know that fish is contributing to our food supply, especially protein supply to our keep growing human population. so that other than from livestock, animal, chicken, beef, and other things, fish is the second largest, other than livestock, to provide us supply with protein. So it is very important. For example, in this new Singapore detected streptococcus, which is streptococcus is a very important bacterial disease, which may can be affected to human food safety for human consumption. So healthy fish means a food safety for us to consume food without infectious agent or organism. So this is in National Geographic. They're also worried about parasite may be gross. I mean, mungkin kamu rasa melihat parasite is something not nice to see. But other than that, food parasite also very important dari segi healthy food untuk kita punya rangkaian menyediakan makanan. So why are fish so important? Because fish are part of our food security. We need to make sure because populasi kita sentiasa bertambah. Ikan yang berada daripada penangkapan daripada laut yang natural, semakin ikan dalam semula jadi semakin berkurang dan manusia semakin bertambah. Oleh itu, aquaculture adalah salah satu kaedah untuk kita dapat membekalkan makanan protein iaitu daripada berasaskan ikan untuk keperluan populasi dunia yang semakin meningkat. So it is a food security. And then how we can help to make sure this food supply is safe and enough to for our consumption untuk menyediakan untuk keperluan penduduk dunia, but also you have to make sure it is sustainable. So to make sure it is sustainable, we have to choose sustainable source for seafood. Jadi we have to change our habit, like avoid plastic so that we don't contribute to the waste in the environment. And then wherever you can reuse, you have or recycle, then you can mulakan dari sekarang to make sure we have a safe environment, so healthy fish, so they can we can have a supply of safe food. So I think that's for today. In summary, I will ask again though, do fish get sick? Adakah akan sakit? Absolutely yes. So how do you know is a fish sick? So you have to know there are physical and behavioral signs. There are types of due to infectious agent and non-infectious. And what to do if you know that your fish is sick? You have to investigate. You do treatment, necessary treatment, and you have to take measure to prevent the event to recur again. Why healthy fish is important? It is for our food safety, it is for our food security, and for our sustainability of seafood supply to supply our population that keep growing. So that's all. Thank you for attending and for your listening. Thank you, Dad.
Thank you very much to Dr. Rafida. It was a very interesting and wonderful topic and very well presented today, as well as it refers with the Institute Penyelidikan Marine Borneo. So we invite some questions to be answered from our guest speakers today. Then that were sent to us during the presentation. So the first question is from Justin Leong. He asked Dr. Rafida, boleh Dr. carangkan ubat atau suplemen yang sesuai untuk dimakan oleh ikan yang sakit?
Okay. Perkara ni saya kena tahu ikan jenis apa, sakit dia apa, dan berapa lama. Sebab itulah kalau kita cadangkan, kalau contohnya untuk bacterial diseases, kalau ikan adanya antibiotik, macam juga manusia ada antibiotik. Tetapi bergantung sama ada ikan tersebut adalah untuk dimakan atau ikan akuarium. Sebabnya kita hendak memastikan penggunaan ubat-ubat secara terkawal. Jadi sebab itulah peranannya doktor veterina untuk memastikan sebelum memberikan ubat-ubatan perlu dipastikan penyakit itu adalah bakteria atau parasit ataupun viral. Untuk viral pula, seperti kamu tahu, seperti juga kes COVID, viral ini selalunya tidak ada ubat. Viral cuma boleh ditangani dengan by giving vaccination. So certain disease due to viral diseases, kita cuma preventive measure by giving vaccination. Memang dari segi aquaculture, big industry aquaculture, they vaccinated their fish in order to protect their investment. So each and everyone, each and setiap ikan itu vaccinated one by one. Sama seperti di dalam industri seperti livestock atau poultry, ayam juga divaksin. Jadi bergantung kepada skala yang kamu maksudkan dan penyakit. Untuk parasit, memang parasit ini environment itu sangat penting. Make sure airnya adalah terjaga, terkawal. Kalau tidak, parasit itu seperti kamu tahu, dia pandai membiak. Jikalau environment itu tidak terkawal, air, kualiti air, maka parasit pula akan makin lama makin banyak. Terdapat contohnya, kalau di hatchery untuk minimakan jangkitan parasit, kalau bagi ikan air masin, ini adalah salah satu rutin kita akan apa ni mandikan macam apa ni dipping dalam air tawar untuk seketika sebagai regular lah, secara berkala dilakukan begitu. Untuk ikan air tawar pula mungkin dimandi rendamkan dalam air masin bergaram sedikit. Tapi ini adalah langkah-langkah pencegahan bergantung kepada severity of the infection. Severity of infection may need more drastic treatment. Contohnya terdapat berbagai jenis ubat untuk parasite. Even ada terdapat ubat cacing juga seperti dalam cat and dogs for our apa ni untuk aquatic animals, but depend aquatic animals itu mana satu? Adakah ini menjawab secara amnya begitulah?
Yeah, thank you, doctor. To the part, the second question from Justin Leong is, Dr. Rafida, pernahkah ikan takut pada bunyi letupan yang kuat seperti mercun? Saya dapati ikan saya terperanjat apabila ada bunyi kuat. Mereka seolah-olah panik.
Ya, sebenarnya sebab itulah ikan ini ada kajian memang dia ada sensory. Maksud dia sensory mungkin bukan dari segi tidak semestinya mendengar, tapi bila ada letupan atau terlalu dekat mungkin ada gegaran wave. Bila air ini, bila ada letupan, air itu sebenarnya ada efek kepada gegaran. Jadi sensory ikan ni dia merasa dari segi gegaran di dalam gelombang air. Badan dia tu ada untuk sense untuk air. Jadi kejutan itu bukan secara direct dari segi mendengar, tapi perubahan pergerakan yang pada environment itu cecair air yang dia, sebab dia punya body, you know kan, kalau kamu dalam air mungkin sensitivity manusia dengan ikan berlainan. Jadi maksudnya skala dia punya sensory itu lebih sensitif, jauh lebih berapa kali ganda sensitif daripada kita. Sebab itulah ikan kadang-kadang if you try to catch ikan di sungai atau di mana, you baru masuk kaki, ikan sudah lari jauh sebab pergerakan gelombang di dalam air itu yang dirasakan oleh sensori ikan itu lebih sangat-sangat terasa lah. Ya, mereka ada, apa ni boleh merasa gegaran yang akibat mungkin daripada letupan.
Okay, thank you. Ada soalan lagi dari Muhammad Afi. Beliau dia cakap, dia tanya, bagaimanakah ikan belaan yang dari kolam tahun ia dipindah ke kolam batu yang bersaiz kecil? Terima kasih.
Bagaimana dia daripada kolam ya?
Kolam tahun ia dipindah ke kolam batu yang bersaiz kecil.
Apa itu kolam tahun? Tahun? Maaf, saya tidak faham itu kolam.
Mungkin kolam yang lama.
Tanah ke kolam? Ya, bila apa-apa saja perubahan bergantung kepada sebenarnya density kadar apa ni kawasan yang diperlukan setiap ikan adalah bergantung kepada saiz ikan. Okey, bagaimana saiz ikan tu dan bagaimana saiz kecil dan besarnya? Mungkin bagi saiz saja, tapi kita kena tahu dia punya isi padu. Begitu, setiap pengiraan keperluan kawasan atau space yang diperlukan setiap ikan bergantung kepada saiz badan dia. Jadi saya perlu tahu ikan tu kalaupun dia di kawasan yang baru, of course bila any new environment, you transfer whatever animals to a new environment, there are stress, but it depends how drastic the changes. Kalau new kolam still apa ni within the space yang sesuai untuk ikan, it's okay. It will take some few days untuk adaptation. Tapi kalau significantly kawasan yang baru itu tidak sesuai dari segi jumlah isi padu dia berbanding dengan keperluan dia, itu tentu akan memberi kesan yang sangat-sangat ketara kepada kesihatan ikan.
Ada
Adakah itu
soalan lagi
menjawab?
daripada pelajar. Saya rasa itu menjawab. Ada soalan lagi daripada pelajar Emma. Dia tanya, Doktor, benarkah semua spesies hidupan laut boleh mengesan kegaran gempa bumi di dasar laut atau tsunami?
Ya, seperti yang saya katakan, ikan ini memang ada sensory. Sebab itulah ikan ini ada sensory dari segi di sepanjang badan dia tu, dia boleh sensor dari segi tekanan, perubahan suhu, even dari segi penglihatan dari segi mata dia. Sebab itulah ikan ini ada mempunyai sensory. Dia boleh merasa perubahan tekanan, which is kalau ada perubahan gelombang pergerakan semua tu dia boleh apa ni merasa. Sebab itulah terdapat spesies ikan yang berlainan pada aras kedalaman yang berlainan. Sebabnya mereka ada adaptability untuk pada tahap kedalaman yang berlainan, pada tahap oksigen yang berlainan, pada tahap cahaya yang berlainan. Dan ada preference pula. Kalau contohnya aquaculture, ikan yang diternak pun ada preference color untuk tangki-tangki yang digunakan. Sebabnya mereka ada sensory untuk melihat dan sensory untuk merasa perubahan sekitaran. Sebab itulah ikan sangat sensitif dari segi kesan environment dia, iaitu air kepada kesihatan dia. Dia punya kesan kualiti air dari segi kualiti fizikal dan juga kualiti dari segi chemical dia sangat besar berbanding daripada kesan parasit itu sendiri atau organism patogen itu sendiri. So first and foremost important kalau nak jaga ikan adalah pastikan kualiti air itu terjaga. Ini termasuklah indirectly lah, memang dia akan merasalah perbezaan kesan-kesan gelombang, contohnya akibat tsunami, semua tu. Ya.
Okay, thank you, dokter. Soalan dari Justin Leong, dia tanya, Dokter Rafida, bolehkah saya terus beri ikan saya makan roti putih?
Ah, okay. Sebenarnya ikan ini ada keperluan protein, karbohidrat, apa ini lagi serat, minerals, vitamin pada kadar yang tertentu. Jikalau makan roti saja, roti itu mungkin kandungannya adalah tinggi karbohidrat, sedangkan peratusan pada nutrisi ikan yang perlu adalah yang lebih tinggi juga adalah protein. Mungkin ikan boleh membesar, tapi tidaklah sesehat atau tidak cukup untuk keperluan pembesaran dia yang seimbang. Jadi sebenarnya ikan juga perlukan formulasi pemakanan yang seimbang, yaitu sebab itulah pada kalau jenis-jenis makanan ikan, kalau kita menternak ikan, untuk ikan kecil dia ada untuk makanan dia. Untuk saiz yang remaja, contohnya juvenile, dia ada kandungan protein yang berbeza. Untuk yang dewasa sudah growing, proteinnya makin berkurang. Seperti juga manusia, kalau baby minum susu sebab perlu banyak protein untuk support pembesaran dia. Tapi kalau orang dewasa tidak perlu mungkin begitu banyak minum susu atau protein yang tinggi sebab kita sudah pembesar dengan stabil, mungkin lebih kepada energi. Jadi bergantung kepada jenis ikan, umur ikan, yang dan ikan ada yang apa nih karnivor, ada yang herbivor, ada yang omnivor. Jadi kalau ikan itu adalah karnivor, kamu cuma beri roti, roti itu adalah karbohidrat, ianya tidak dapat membantu langsung keperluan ikan tersebut. Jadi ini pun akan menyebabkan stres, tekanan. Sebab itu bukan dia punya makanan yang dapat support untuk dia punya keperluan fizikal untuk pembesaran dan juga fisiologikal punya growth.
Okay, doktor. Soalan yang terakhir, bagaimanakah cara untuk mengesan secara fizikal sekiranya ikan berkenaan dicemari oleh merkuri?
Okay, merkuri ini secara fizikal susah juga kita hendak apa ni cek ya, sebab saya tahu memang mungkin merkuri akan, sebab efek merkuri ini adalah kumulatif, dianya adalah kumulatif, dia ambil masa yang lama untuk merkuri itu berada dalam badan dan menyebabkan dia kerosakan atau penyakit. Tidak seperti bakteria atau organism yang kamu akan nampak bila severity atau terlalu banyak patogenik itu menjangkiti, kamu akan nampak sign. Tapi kalau heavy metals, mercury, plumbum, sulfur, semua itu adalah dalam kategori logam berat. Logam berat ini kesannya adalah secara kumulatif. Ambil masa untuk dia tahap dalam tahap level yang tidak boleh diterima, yang mana selalunya akan dapat dikesan seperti pada otak, organ otak atau organ dalaman seperti apa ni hati, kidney, yang mana dianya memerlukan pemeriksaan secara makmal. Perlu antar sampel sama ada sampel muscle dia, sebabnya merkuri ini dia itulah dia terkumpul dalam tisu untuk jangka masa, ambil masa lah sampai dia cut off level yang tidak lagi yang bahaya, then dia akan ada kesan lah secara internal organ selalunya. Sangat susah untuk kita untuk kita apa ni evaluate dari segi physically sahaja.
Okay, ada soalan lagi daripada peserta kita. Sekiranya terdapat ikan yang sakit di dalam akuarium yang mengandungi berbagai jenis ikan, perlukah saya asingkan ikan yang sakit sahaja untuk diberikan rawatan atau berikan rawatan kepada keseluruhan akuarium berkenaan untuk mengelakkan jangkitan, doktor?
Ya, kalau satu akuarium ada pelbagai jenis ikan dan ada ikan yang telah sakit, ikan yang sakit perlu diasingkan, memang perlu diasingkan, tapi dalam masa yang sama perlu ambil langkah berjaga-jaga untuk ikan yang masih sehat, sebab kadang-kadang ikan itu masih menampakkan dia sehat tapi sebenarnya telah dijangkiti. Maka perlu ada proses pembersihan apa ni air yang pastikan jikalau itu adalah bakteria bahawa apa ni air yang telah dicemari itu tidak lagi mencemari ikan yang lain, sebab mereka adalah satu dalam satu environment yang sama, dalam dalam satu media yang sama. Kalau ada satu ekor ikan sudah sakit dan jikalau ianya bakteria, sebenarnya bakteria itu ada sudah di dalam aquarium tersebut. Cuma susceptibility atau ketahanan ikan secara individu adalah berbeza. Mungkin ikan yang kecil lebih senang terjangkit, atau ikan yang cukup makan sehat dia lebih tahan dari segi daya ketahanan dia. Walau bagaimanapun air yang telah tercemar itu maksudnya possibilities perlu air yang terawat, air yang cukup apa ni peredarannya untuk memastikan tidak ada bakteria yang akan membiak lebih banyak lagi. Kerana jangkitan bagi jangkitan seperti bakteria, virus dengan apa ni parasit, kadang-kadang dia mengambil dia kematian dia adalah atau menunjukkan sakit dia adalah secara mengambil masa yang lama. Seekor hari ini, besok dua ekor, besok selagi organisma itu ada dalam persekitarannya.
Oke, dokter. Ada soalan lagi daripada Muhammad Afdi. Bagaimanakah hendak memastikan ikan itu tidak terkena sakit dan keracunan?
Oke. Keracunan dari segi ikan ni dia boleh keracunan secara bahan kimia ataupun keracunan dari segi perubahan air tersebut. Contohnya, jikalau kamu memberi makanan ikan berlebihan daripada keperluannya. Contohnya sehari ikan perlu makan 5% daripada berat badannya saja. Kamu bagi sampai 10% atau 20%. Makanan ini akan terbuang, apa ni terbuang terampai di dalam kolam atau di dalam tangki atau di dalam akuarium. Makanan ini adalah mengandungi protein yang tinggi. Jadi makanan ini akan mengubah kepada amonia, nitrat di dalam air itu atau pH dalam air air tersebut. Environment dia, dan makanan ini akan menjadi toksik sebabnya dia mengubah kualiti air. Sebab itulah perlu pemberian makanan yang mencukupi secukupnya. Tidak boleh berlebihan. Kalau berlebihan akan menjadi toksik sebabnya dia akan diuraikan. Ataupun toksik juga boleh secara bahan kimia. Atau contohnya air daripada sungai yang tercemar. Itu juga toksik. Okay. Atau air dalam tangki yang tidak dicukup dia punya pengudaran perawatan atau penggantian air. Air harus perlu bergerak sebab setiap ikan yang makan dia akan menghasilkan kumbahan. Kumbahan ini pula akan mengganggu, akan menghasilkan nitrogen kan. Bila setiap kumbahan akan ada nitrogen, akan ada nitrat, dia akan mengubah kandungan amonia di dalam air. Jadi perlu ditukar air tersebut agar tidak terkumpul tahap mengganggu tahap ketoksikan dia. Jadi air sangat-sangat kritikal untuk menternak ikan atau menjaga ikan.
Oke, doktor. Itulah soalan yang terakhir. So, we hope you all enjoy this amazing, interesting presentation by our wonderful speakers today. The link for registrations and e-certificate is now being shared for school students and UMS students. Please fill in your details and answer the simple feedback questionnaire. All students will be received an e-certificate and STP point for UMS students only. Okay, thank you again, Dr. Rafida.
Thank you, Miss Lee.
those questions and for the amazing presentation. Thank you also all the audience today for your participation. We're looking forward to seeing you in the next STEM speaker series scheduled on 21st October. It was a pleasure to have you all with us. With this, we conclude this webinar. Thank you and see you again. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Okay. Okay, itu saja.